Breaking Bad, The Simpsons, Lazy Town. What I've just named are TV juggernauts, series that took the world by storm and became number one in our hearts. But the road to becoming a TV legend is a treacherous one, filled with cancellations, writer strikes, and Hitler. More on that later. Sometimes you can see from the start that a show is doomed to failure, the stars just haven't aligned and the cards are stacked against it, and it's just so fun to see these train wrecks explode in a shower of awkwardness and poor production. With this in mind, I'm Jules for WhatCulture.com and this is 10 TV shows that were doomed from the start. Number 10, Baywatch Nights. To say that Baywatch Nights, a spin-off to the successful TV series about scantily clad lifeguards, was an error in judgment is like saying the game Doom is a tad violent. A detective show starring David Hasselhoff's lifeguard, each episode would feature a Magnum PI-style plot in the hours after his day job had finished. As you can imagine, the show was about as deep as a puddle of termite vomit, and the first season saw craptastic ratings. As a knee-jerk reaction, they decided to make season 2 about the supernatural, which went about as well as you could expect and was cancelled before the season ended. Number 9. Dollhouse. Dollhouse focused around the concept that people could just have their memories and personalities artificially wiped, existing as blank slates which could then be programmed with any persona and skill set you could imagine. Sounds cool, right? And you can imagine that in the hands of a skilled and engaged actor, the role of lead doll Echo would be a godsend. Sadly, they didn't cast a skilled and engaged actor, they cast Eliza Dushku. She proved on Buffy and Angel that she can play a fiery ass-kicker, but asking her to step into such a challenging role was like expecting a corner shop to sell foie gras. Dollhouse was cancelled at the end of season 2 amidst low ratings and a history of editorial intervention from Fox, and for a change, there weren't that many naysayers to that decision. Number 8. Joey. After the 10th and final season of Friends, fans and critics alike were curious as to what the central cast would get up to now that the vehicle that had made them super rich household names was gone. Most middled in TV and film, as you would expect, but Matt LeBlanc decided he wasn't ready to hang up his how you doings. He spun straight off into Joey, a sitcom about his character and Friends moving to LA and pursuing his acting career. Groan! And then because it didn't work immediately, the writers turned him into an emotionally insecure male in need of love, just like every other sitcom male. Somewhat predictably, Joey didn't bring the massive Friends audience with it, and the show was cancelled after only 2 seasons. Number 7. Studio 60 on the Sunset Strip. This show could have been the best show. It was Aaron Sorkin's first TV foray after The West Wing and had Bradley Whitford and Matthew Perry as the leads. And it was about writing a comedy show, so it held the potential to get more meta than a certain Smash Bro warrior.
Fight me.
But this show tanked. And it was all down to the way in which Sorkin approached the writing of the show within his show. He seemed to forget that the sketches needed to be funny and not a vehicle for topical issues. It made the show too serious and the characters too world-weary to be enjoyed. Worse still, 30 Rock debuted in the same year and decimated its viewer base, showing that sketch show writing was meant to be, you know, fun. Number 6. Cop Rock. Airing for one 11-episode season on ABC in 1990 and created by legendary writer and producer Stephen Bochco, Cop Rock was a down-and-dirty police procedural with a difference, in that it incorporated elements of musical theatre into the production of every episode. Yeah, I'm not sure how they sneaked this one past ABC's executives either. As you'd expect, critics were totally nonplussed at the juxtaposition between procedural elements and choreographed gospel, rock and pop tunes that the cast would break into at key moments in the drama. And I mean, rightly so, how would you deal with somebody bursting into song if you've just found a dead teenager in a bin bag? Number 5. WBF Body Stars. In 1991 and 1992, Vince McMahon, aka the father of the Bod Pod which spurts out oiled men to tickle fight other men, decided to start WBF Body Stars, a weekly show dedicated to pushing the worked personas of his body stars and their physiques. That's right, Vince McMahon was trying to build an allegedly legitimate bodybuilding franchise to take over from the industry leader by co-opting the gimmicks and cartoon showmanship that he brought to professional wrestling. He is not a well man. The WBF was an unmitigated disaster. Bodybuilding just isn't a spectator sport, and those that follow this niche activity and competition are precisely the kind of people who'd be incredibly annoyed by McMahon's cheesy presentation. It was such a bad idea that other bad ideas got together and tried to stage an intervention to get it the help that it needed. Number 4. My Mother the Car. Running on ABC in the mid-1960s, this weird little fantasy sitcom featured Dick Van Dyke's kid brother Jerry, who impulsively purchases a 1928 Porter touring car, which turns out to be the reincarnation of his deceased mother.
What?
That's right, a dead mother in a car driven by Dick Van Dyke's brother. The show features all the wacky adventures you'd expect from a format based around a family member being imbued into a motor vehicle, robbers, car collectors trying to steal her, and... Look, I'm really struggling here. Who the f*** thought this was a good idea? You know what, let's just motor on. Wait! Number 3, Gotham. The problem with Gotham is that while it does give interesting new insights into an iconic superhero's past, it also dredges the boring and unimportant fluff along with it. Loud, brash call forwards to well-known elements of the Batman mythos have become the show's rather embarrassing calling card, leading to many "do you get it" moments, inevitably followed by the "oh, do you get it yet, do you get it" as the show's writers milk the Batman connection for all it's worth. I love Batman, and under his rubber cowl I know he loves me. And this show neither loves me nor the Bat, as it routinely insults the intelligence of the viewer while pretending that its tenuous links are super clever or mind-blowing revelations. Number 2. Osborne's Reloaded. The Osborne's original foray onto reality TV was something of a spectacular oddity. It was like watching a heavily sedated baboon being introduced to modern society, and it was utterly compelling. Unfortunately, as the series continued and the Wizard of Oz grew in popularity not seen since his drug-fueled musical heyday, gears began to turn in the minds of TV executives. So somebody decided to give this melting pot of a family a variety show, because, you know, a clan fronted by a man less articulate than a lobotomy patient seems like a great host. Needless to say, this batshit crazy show had its head well and truly bitten off just after one season. And number 1, Heil Honey, I'm Home. Oh god, I told you we'd get back to that whole Hitler thing, and boy is this a humdinger of a closer. Literally the worst thing that's ever happened to television, Heil Honey, I'm Home was presented to the UK in September 1990. Only one episode was ever broadcast. It was that bad. The gloriously trashy premise saw Adolf Hitler and Eva Braun living next door to a Jewish couple, the Goldsteins, and hijinks ensued through Hitler's inability to coexist with them. The whole thing was intended to be a satire of 1950s US sitcoms, not to trivialise Nazism, the Holocaust, or Britain's war heroes, but naturally the satire was too heavy-handed to penetrate or amuse, leading the show to trivialise Nazism, the Holocaust, and Britain's war heroes. 8 episodes in all were planned for the series, none of which made it to air except the pilot. Whispers fly around to this day that all 8 are completed somewhere and that they still exist. And so it is with great joy that I can announce that I, Jules Gill, am starting an expedition to the cellars of What Culture Towers, where such reels are sure to be found. Wish me luck! And that's our list. Got any more shows that didn't make the cut? Well, let us know about them in the comments section below. And if you want to come and try and cancel me, then you can do so over on Twitter at RetroJ with a 0. If you like this video, then like, share, and subscribe for more. As always, I've been Jules for WhatCulture.com, and I'll speak to you soon.